The banking industry is facing a turbulent time. Strong shifts in the way people manage their money were happening before the pandemic, which makes this time even more compelling. High street players are now in a perilous position, while the competition amongst fintechs continues to grow. So who will prevail? And with that, what does the future hold for all of us? We've conducted a thorough analysis of industry trends, who's capitalising, and what they are using. This video is brought to you by Posito. If you're an entrepreneur or an industry marketer, then you may be interested in reading the associated posit at posito.co.uk. We begin by covering the trends in the run-up to the pandemic before assessing its impact on them. Consumers now expect to manage their money at a moment's notice, although it's easy to forget that this was unavailable until recently. Only a decade or so ago, we were still using archaic systems which made financial management a chore. We have also only just recovered from the 2007 financial crisis, which had a dramatic impact on the global economy. The Financial Conduct Authority and Prudential Regulation Authority began a financial overhaul that included new legislation to spread risk, economic stability, and spur competition in a once dull and lifeless market. In the aftermath, high street banks have struggled to provide a consistent, reliable service for changing consumer requirements. Where the high street banks have faltered, challenges have entered, disrupting an industry that previously relied on loyalty, with customers staying with the bank for an average of 17 years. 40% of 18 to 27 year olds now choose challenger banks as their main accounts. Furthermore, challengers have capitalised on low levels of financial literacy. Challengers have bridged this gap by delivering insights and educational content to help consumers understand their money. Consequently, millennials are now more open to a wider range of services than older demographics. Despite a delayed response, incumbents now realise the threat presented by challengers. London leads the way in fintech innovation, beating its American and European rivals in terms of investment volume. The flourishing fintech capital is also home to around 70% of UK's fintech firms and in close proximity to regulators and accelerators which provide instant growth opportunities. This has led to a technological arms race for all the market players. Significant investments in machine learning and AI have been supported by the Bank of England and the FCA. Two-thirds of financial institutions now use big data to revolutionise the customer experience, marketing and fraud prevention functions. Data harvesting giants have also begun to dabble in the payments market, with open banking being a potential way into the space. Despite this, people have been reluctant so far to hand over their data to third parties. However, in the long run, the convenience aspects may overcome privacy concerns. The fight for talent has been led by influential visionaries within fintech players. Yet despite this, fintechs have struggled to attract sufficient recruits with specialist skill sets. Finding candidates with both compliance capabilities and technological expertise has not been easy. In addition, the fintech industry is dependent on the rest of the world for around 40% of its workforce, which presents an uncertain future in the midst of a post-Brexit Britain. The pandemic has placed extraordinary pressures on high street banks. Aside from the logistical challenges of running empty branches and serving digitally illiterate customers, they've had to set aside billions of pounds to cover potential bad loans that businesses may not be able to pay back. Yet trust and loyalty remain heavily in their favour. They still hold around 75% of retail and 85% of business accounts. Meanwhile, challenger brands are having to do more with less as VC and interchange incomes dry up. Growth activities have slowed significantly with a renewed focus on profitability. Some challengers have also fared better than others, with current successes being influenced by the diversity of their revenue streams. Banking's Big Four are the UK's most prolific players, with arms stretching beyond the UK market. These are Barclays, Lloyds, HSBC and NatWest, which rebranded from RBS at the start of this year to shake off its associations with the financial crisis. The pandemic has had a dramatic impact on revenues in the first half of this year, although it's important to consider that most profit increases before it resulted from significant cost-cutting measures. Further still, Brexit uncertainties and the threat of disruption have eroded their brand equity, with a collective £1.6 billion being written off before the start of this year. Multi-currency magnate Revolut is leading the charge with a healthy presence in Europe. The company has already amassed around 8 million customers and a valuation of around $5.5 billion. Revolut's CEO attributes the firm's success to its divisive culture, as outlined in the Revolut Way. Among UK fintechs, Monzo holds over 50% of the challenger market with more than 3 million customers. It boasts a net promoter score of 80+, which far exceeds the industry average of just 25. Yet the company's US expansion has been pegged back by the pandemic, a logistical challenge that favours the US's own crop of fintech upstarts. Berlin-based N26 is Europe's most valuable fintech, with notable investors including Insight Partners, Alliance and Tencent Holdings. Its focus on a more mature demographic has been a key feature of its ability to surpass 1 billion euros in deposits so quickly. Starling Bank holds over 1 million retail accounts and 80,000 business accounts through a UK-centric approach with an emphasis on SMEs. This success has been accelerated by investment of well over £300 million since its launch in 2014. The sizeable gap between the revenues of high street banks and challengers has led to distinct differences in their growth strategies. The Big Four are known for their ability to generate sustained awareness through TV advertising, a notable feature during the pandemic. Across the board, however, marketing strategies have become increasingly data-led, with a focus on digital channels that provide a clear return on investment. Recent research suggests that email, social and paid search yield the best results for lead generation and retention in financial services. For example, Starling saw great success after a Facebook campaign that reduced acquisition costs by 35% and provided a 32% lead conversion rate. Referrals have also provided a large component of challenger growth, accounting for 80% of Monzo's customer acquisition. Similarly, Revolut has incentivized new sign-ups with its Pioneer program, which offers cash and free cards in return for referrals. By contrast, high street players have previously offered payments for switching, although this approach has an impact on loyalty. In addition, a combination of cost-effective inbound marketing and SEO has been used to reinforce brand values and provide value to potential customers. Keen to keep costs down, this serves as the bedrock for Monzo's digital presence. Monzo creates accessible and educational blog posts on financial literacy. This helped it to match incumbent search volumes in just 2 years. Both high street banks and fintechs have impressive in-house capabilities. This has been driven by a requirement to manage vast amounts of data across a range of channels. That said, because of their limited budgets, fintechs are best known for this. For example, as mentioned earlier, Monzo's extensive social listening and content marketing program is managed in-house. And there are many tools designed for this purpose, such as SEMrush and KISS Metrics. Scalable CRM tools such as Salesforce and HubSpot have also become popular choices for improving lead generation and customer experience. Incumbents are known for long-standing relationships with some of the world's leading agencies. Global agencies like VCCP and Adam & Eve DDB are popular choices. Meanwhile, NatWest sought a new approach at the end of last year, handing its £35 million account to the In Partnership in the face of disruption by challengers. Halifax and NatWest have also sought help from Rufus Leonard and Futurebrand respectively to revitalise their visual identities. With tighter budgets, challengers outsource unfamiliar activities to smaller creative agencies. These complement in-house efforts and aim to target societal issues that incumbents fail to cover. Starling's £2 million budget led to it taking on Wonderhood Studios and Bountiful Cow in a bid to drive awareness. Ecstasy also created a Feel Good About Money campaign that led to Starling being named Best British Bank in 2019. If you're an entrepreneur deciding whether to enter this highly competitive market, then you may realise the scale of the challenge ahead of you. Societal media and regulatory trends make it difficult for any new entrant. That said, as always, authenticity and consistency are essential if you are to succeed. You will also need a significant runway of investment. If you're already operating, then success will be down to the way you use your existing awareness. As we've seen, each of the major players has a very different set of attributes, and this can be evaluated in more detail if you watch our video on the 7 elements to every purchase. Of course, if you'd like us to create a strategy for you, then we've developed a service for that exact purpose. Thank you for watching. Subscribe to watch related videos and give it a like if you want other people to discover it. Until next time.